following program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.
Hi, this is The Art of Politics. I'm Bill O'Brien. I'm with my good friend, Nashua Democrat, State Representative Ken Gidge. Ken lets me come into this city periodically, and he allows me to join him on the show. Ken, how are you?
That's not factual. Well, there's a lot of Republican gods out there following him in. Well, last week, we had quite a blowout over the insurance thing. I mean, we're not sure how that's going to work out, but since I did actually was a little outrageous, I think, tonight, what topics would you like to talk about?
Well, you know, there's just so much going on. Obviously, many people are concerned internationally what's going to happen with the situation in the Middle East and in Syria. Certainly, people continue to be worried about the economy. We have an economy that, even in the fifth year after the president has taken office, continues to sort of languish in the doldrums.
Really? So let me see. We sold more cars in the third this last in August than any time in the history of automaking. Our stock market is booming. House prices are now going up, and you're saying, and we just found out that it's 7.2. We've gone down a half a percent in unemployment, so that's all bad?
Actually, 7.3, and yeah, it's all bad, because what has happened is that 10 million fewer people are working, have left the labor force entirely since President Obama took over. We've had one of the most tepid, it's a real polite way of saying, one of the worst recoveries that we've had certainly since the Great Depression.
At
some point you have to stop saying, Hoover caused it or George Bush caused it. What we know is that in the fifth year of the Obama presidency, when he came in, over 60% of the people, of the adults were working. Now we're down to around 58%. We're talking about six out of every seven jobs that have been formed have been part-time jobs. We're talking about the fact that 53% of jobs pay $30,000 or less a year. We're heading down the drain here, and we're heading down the drain because government has been too involved in the economy.
Well,
government isn't allowing the free market system to work.
You may not be able, you may say what you want, obviously, but really going down, and you say it's going up because people are not, are leaving the job market, but car sales, and the Republicans really wanted to, let the car companies go bankrupt, and yet car companies are, 12% up?
Yeah, let's talk about that.
And then our stock market is one of the strongest in the world. It seems that our economy and how much of it was in shambles is stronger than any other economy in the world?
Oh, actually, it's not. The German economy has an unemployment rate of 5.1%. And we're at 7.3%.
You are correct.
The German economy is stronger.
Yeah,
probably the Chinese economy, which is still growing at 7 or 8% a year, is stronger. You keep on mentioning, you've done a number of shows, Ken, and mentioned the automobile industry, and we wanted to let it go bankrupt and so forth. Well, the fact is, it did go bankrupt. The General Motors went through bankruptcy. That's one thing to remember. The second thing is, look at what government did. Look what the federal government did. They took those TARP funds, that was an acronym for Toxic Asset Recovery Program. They took TARP funds, and they gave money to Chrysler to pay off its debt, and then they sold it to Fiat for nothing. Then they took...
It's not what the president of Fiat says.
Then
$25 billion, he had to pay back.
No, that's not right. Then, but the point I was going to make is General Motors, we are still $20 or $30 billion down on that today of the TARP funds we gave. And basically, they took away all the value from the shareholders. They defrauded the creditors. They paid off the union contracts and the union pension fund and gave 60% of the value of General Motors to the unions. So what it was an old-time payback by a Chicago Paul to his supporters. That's what General Motors amounted to.
You're not for the unions.
I am for organized labor in our history. It did some great things. What has happened now is it's not doing great things. It's bankrupting our cities. Look at Detroit. It will bankrupt our states.
Look at Illinois, California, other states.
Detroit's
a good thing to look at. It was over a million people. Now it's down to like 537,000. You know, almost 50% of the city has left. You know, you have to run from your police departments to your fire departments. You have to do all those things anyway, and you have lost half of your people, which are taxpayers into the city. So Detroit is kind of an interesting, you know, it's an interesting place.
What it shows is that when there's bad government, people can vote with their feet. They'll leave. And that's what happened in Detroit. It had bad government. Yeah, people left. There's other cities that went from Pittsburgh, for example, went from a transition of being an old-time manufacturing city to a city that is in financial services and medical services.
But you're
now,
not saying
very
it was the federal government that made Detroit what it is.
No, I'm saying it's Democrat politics.
Oh, okay.
And it's big government politics.
Politics and war. What's going on with Syria?
You know, and here's an area that I think many of us might agree, or at least people agree without regard to, you know, whether you are on one side of the political spectrum or another. You don't have to be an isolationist. And I know people accused, and some of the Republicans opposing President Obama, involving us militarily in Syria. You don't have to be...
What do you think, but when you say
involvement,
how do you mean?
You don't have to be an isolationist.
How do you mean that? Feet on the ground?
No, any sort of a military attack, military involvement. It's a bad...
You against giving money and arms to the resistance, fighting against the...
A good portion of the resistance are al-Qaeda. Affiliated.
Sadly, this is what happened in Afghanistan also.
You know...
We gave money when they were fighting Russia, and now we're using the guns against
us. Taliban, yeah. I agree. And that shows the unintended consequences of getting involved in an area of the world which has certain trends that are going to play themselves out, whether or not you get involved.
Poison gas. 1,400 people killed.
It's a nasty world out there, and you want to know what? A million people over the past 10 years have died in Congo. And do we hear things about Congo? Is anyone saying the U.S. needs to get militarily involved in the Congo?
I happen to agree with you.
It's a bad world out there.
Poison gas. I mean, is there a line in your life that you, as a Republican, can say, we must stop this any way we can from people using it?
Any way we can. That's the problem.
And that's called militarily.
We're not the world's policemen, Ken. We can't afford to be.
If we're not,
we don't have the right to be.
If we're not, who is?
There may not be.
Does the world need a policeman?
There may not be. And that may be a rhetorical question, because the world's not going to get a policeman. What it's going to get is a hegemonic power, such as the United States has been, but we're running out of money to have that kind of overarching influence in the world. We can't prevent bad things from happening
in
the world.
Where is the line where people are using gas to kill people? What line do you have where you say, we must do something about it if no one else will do anything about it?
Again, I'm not sure that that's a legitimate question, because it assumes there must be a line. I look at this from an entirely different perspective. The perspective I think many of us look at is say, is the U.S., are our national interests involved in this? Is it going to make the world a safer or a less safe place for America?
Well,
if we answer that it will make it a safer place, then we have to ask ourselves, is the effort worth?
What does Syria border? What countries does Syria border?
On the Mediterranean side, Lebanon, and the north, Turkey, to the east, Iraq, and in the south, Jordan and Israel.
Israel,
you know, believe it or not, has a great deal of ability to take care of itself.
Yeah, I understand that, but
I'm a real supporter of Israel.
Supposedly, and they, you know, the prophecies that's where World War III is going to begin. But no, I want to hold you down on one thing, because I think we agree militarily. Please, let's not do anything more. I could see probably, and I mean this, calling up the Syrians and say, look, we want to prove our point that we can kill you if we want to, so we want you to get out of your city hall because we're going to blow it up. I mean, I look at it in those terms. We don't even have to do anything. We press a button, the thing goes over, bang, okay, now you know it, don't do it again. But you, is it 100,000 people? If no one else wants to do anything, the American steps in. Is it 100,000 people must die with gas before you say America's got to do something?
Again, I'm not judging that question based on the criteria you want to introduce. What is more important is it good for the United States? Is it going to be advantaging our national interest, or is it not?
Well, I wanted you to mention who were the allies right around, you know, where Syria is. Israel is one. Jordan doesn't seem to be. I'm not sure where Jordan is. I mean, they're trying to straddle of being neutral, almost like a Switzerland, but they can't.
Yeah, I mean, as best as a country in that area can be, it's our ally. What is it, the 29th Infantry Division is still in Jordan right now? They went over, a couple of months ago, maybe 6 months, I don't know, a while ago, to have, like, military exercises. No, by the way, they haven't left. And
I think that's an example of what I mean about. But I want to get out of you. How many people, a million people have to die with gas before you finally say, if nobody else is going to do anything, us here in the U.S. ought to do something about it?
You want to know what? One American dies, then we do something about it. And if the use of gas is challenging our ability to keep Americans safe, then we do something about it. If it's just some roaming bad guy, then we go to the UN and we say, you want to get together and help it? And if you have a China and you have a Soviet Union, because they act like the Soviet Union, you have a Russian Federation, a Putin who says, oh, well, you know, no, we don't. You have a Germany and a Japan and a Great Britain who sit back and go, what a nasty guy that is, using gas and all, but no, we're not going to do anything. You want to know what? Let's not do anything either.
Well, I happen to disagree with you. In fact, supposedly this isn't the first time they used it. This is the first time. In fact, that's the reason why the inspectors were over there, to find out if they have used it. But it's interesting. 1,400 people. I will bet you, out of the people who died by gas, and I'm not just talking about this one in Syria, but the other time they supposedly used the gas, I'll bet you there's a Syrian American over there, a Syrian who went back to their country either to fight for or against it. I'll bet you there is one one American called Syrian, which I think is still an American citizen, may not have been born here. I'll bet you we can find one. Now.
because one Syrian immigrant decides to go back and join the rebels or something.
We're going to American.
We're going to go get involved in war.
Hey, look,
you know, our federal government has an obligation to protect us. Our federal government doesn't have an obligation to roam the world trying to be a policeman and trying to figure out the morality and when immorality becomes numerically sufficient that we want to get involved. The one criteria that is important is our federal government acting in a way that keeps us safe from foreign enemies and potential foreign enemies? Going beyond that...
Well, our allies, Jordan and Israel, I would say, and Egypt, which is certainly in the vicinity. Do we protect our... If Syria decides to say, okay, we're going to lose and... Assad is afraid they're going to hang him in the square, decides to go over with the gas and wipe out a million people. Supposedly they have that potential. So isn't stopping it right at the very beginning important? You don't think we should be involved with it?
I don't think we should be involved in it. If we had good intelligence that said that there was going to be a widespread use against American allies, then we should consult with the allies and say what's an appropriate response.
Well,
is there a need for a preemptive attack? Do you have the capability of doing it? Are good friends. But if it's just he's going to be a little bit nastier to his people, then we would be to our own, and that we would certainly like to see people be. That doesn't invoke, in and of itself, national interest. It just doesn't.
Well, I think you and I are on the same page. We're from an era where we have seen enough wars from Vietnam we've had it, okay? I think Iraq was probably one of the great eras in the history of mankind regarding wars.
Wow. I mean, one of the great eras, and then you added that in the history of mankind. Probably in the history of mankind.
But we can kill more people quickly.
There's been some, but you and I probably agree on at least the course that war took. I certainly think that we had a reason to believe that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction. He was trying to make us believe he did, and he miscalculated. He thought he could keep us away from him by saying he did and acting like he did, and it turned out it caused us to go in there.
What surprises me is Colin Powell.
Well, I think he was given inaccurate intelligence assessments, and he went with them. What bothered me about that is we chose to go to war. We go to war to accomplish a specific purpose, and we don't have this mission creep. The purpose was they have weapons of mass destruction. You drive up the river, which we showed we could do pretty well. You take out the government. On the way, it would seem to me an intelligent approach would have been to call up the second-tier generals and say, we're coming, and we're going to beat your army, and we're going to let you take over afterwards, and then we're going to drive down the river.
Yeah.
And we're not going to destroy it. Just don't do this anymore.
That was Brenner, who Bush sent over there, supposedly. They cleaned it up. At that time, from what I have heard, that there were generals. The police would have stayed where they were.
Yeah.
The generals would have stayed. Now, that doesn't mean the people who were for Saddam would have been there. I think the generals would have taken the generals out who were for him and shot them. But you would have had a military which would watch their own people. You would have had police to watch their own people. And guess what we did? Brenner came over and said, no, we're not going to have anything to do with it.
And guess what else? And we agree on this. The end result 10 years later is going to be exactly the same for the Iraqis, which is you have nasty government running Iraq that people are shooting at, and it's shooting at people, and it's treating its people badly, and there's a lot of violence. The only difference would have been that the United States wouldn't have spent $1 trillion of its national treasure, and we wouldn't have thousands of some of our best young people,
6,000 something, who were
killed, and most importantly, maimed.
Shameful. And I can see that's why we're against doing much in Syria. Are you? I know it was kind of a joke. I said, look, tell them we're going to blow up their palace. Everyone get out. But that's maybe not that far-fetched. So what would you be willing, because of the tear gas, would you be willing to say, okay, we're going to send a few cruise missiles, no feet on the ground, that's it. And we're going to just take out just some place. We're not going to do the bridges or the power plants as they did in Iraq, which was really dumb. Would you go along with something like that?
Well, I mean, when you say would I go along, would I approve of that? No, I think it's a wasted effort. I don't think in the end it'll make any difference.
Getting rid of him is not going to make a difference?
Well, you didn't say get rid of him. Moreover, getting rid of Assad, I don't know that that's to the U.S. advantage, because who replaces Assad? It's going to be a bunch of jihadists, Islamic fundamentalists, and al-Qaeda operatives.
How do we get in this position?
Yeah, I mean, just...
How did the world get in this position?
Because we became overly involved. I mean, look at this Arab Spring. There's been those in the administration who glorify the Arab Spring, and they somehow think that this is a good thing. And what has it done? In Egypt, it brought in Islamic fundamentalists who were looking to have a fight with Israel, were oppressing the people much worse than Mubarak had ever done. As opposed to just leaving things the way they were, which is, no day at the beach, Mubarak.
You know what it is? It's one good thing about the Constitution of the United States, as much as it can be interpreted, and that is to keep church and state out of government. You can be your Catholic. I can be my Protestant or Methodist. I can't remember exactly. But you can be who you want, we can be in government, but the religion does not run the government. And over there, it's Muslims who want the Muslim government. And all of a sudden, you got your religions that the interpretation of it, as I said, for us over here, the interpreting of some of this. Women can't go out without men. Husband is killed in a war, so a woman can't leave the house even to get food. They get gotten beaten up. This happened in Afghanistan, and that's one of the reasons why we're.
Right.
Would you agree that the here in our Constitution, one of the good things is separation of church and state?
I do, and it's actually maybe the reason we're one of the most religious people in the world.
Good point.
Because it's not something that's mandated by government.
Protect religion.
We protect it, but we don't establish. We protect choice, and so people don't think that they're compelled towards any one religion. You know, obviously, because I bring it up a bit, I've spent time in Germany, for example, and there they have, believe it or not, still some government taxes that go to support churches. You know, if you've been over in Europe, you see these wonderful cathedrals. I mean, they're just beautiful.
Well, they're not necessarily doing the religion. They're smart enough to say, let's get these cathedrals back up because they're bringing
don't. It's not for that reason. It's just historical that if you're Catholic, you pay a portion of your taxes go to support the church. And there was a time 300 years ago that, that was entirely appropriate because there was little separation between the church and the state.
Since then,
it's historical. Yeah. But people feel, they take some money and you have these cathedrals, but they're not very religious. Here, we don't do that. And so I think that we tend to be religious people because it's a matter of free choice. We can think about it. We can think about how we want our lives to be and what's meaningful, and we go to religion as a matter of free choice.
I had a friend, Abdi, who was an Iranian. And he was here for so many years and then became an American citizen. And he didn't want to really basically tell anyone. And I found out, I said, well, congratulations. I mean, good, I'm glad you're here. And I've known you for about 5 or 6 years. And, you're honest, you're hardworking individual. Why wouldn't you want to say that you've become an American? He says, it's two things. He says, I'm an Iranian. When the transition in Iran took place, his parents got them out of there. He says, we come to America. He says, my God, he says, you cannot believe how free we are to practice our own faith of Islam, because there are two sort of forms of Islam, and that's what
generally,
many times
yes.
that they're fighting yeah. about. So you're right.
But why, I'm curious, Ken, why did you understand he didn't want to be Oh, he didn't want to be identified as an Iranian.
He didn't want to tell anyone. He told a few people, and it got back to me, and I went over and I asked him, and he's, you know, it's still this little that one is against people of different, him being an Iranian, not looking.
You know, this is a great book I would recommend to you by a really well-researched and thoughtful British historian. His name is Bernard Lewis. And the name of the book is What Went Wrong. And he talks about what went wrong in the Islamic world, why this portion of the world has fallen behind politically, economically, socially. And I must say that he does attribute it to the religion that they hold, because it's such a, this is really simplified, but it's such an all-encompassing worldview in which all knowledge comes from their deity, that it tends to suppress any alternate political choices or economic choices or scientific
women.
Choices. Yeah, very interesting analysis.
Well, I'm good. And the name of the book is?
What Went Wrong.
Okay, What Went Wrong. If we were going to talk about books that we are reading, anything, you're reading that now? I have read that. What are you reading
Well, I
now?
Read that some time back. Now I'm actually still reading, and I've been so busy actually in the new job I have. I haven't had time to get along as far in it as I would. What's called Warrior Cops. It was published about, I think about 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago.
Warrior Cops by who?
The fellow's name is like Ratko Bradley or something like that, bulky. Very unusual name, but if you look it up, it's on the New York Times bestseller list.
Okay.
Warrior Cops. And what it does is it talks about the militarization of the police in our country. Starting in the 1960s with, you might remember the name, the Los Angeles chief of police was Robert Gates or Gately, or I'm trying to remember, and he's the one who set up the first SWAT unit. He actually came up with the term SWAT, Special Weapons and Tactics, and he did it as a political thing. He just wanted to call them military unit of the police or something like that.
Okay, we have about 1 minute left. I want to tell you something historically that one might not know, because I've been reading the presidents. Todd Lincoln was at the bedside of his father. He was also in the same train station because I believe he was in the cabinet of Garfield. So he saw Garfield. He was with McKinley when McKinley was assassinated. He was with three presidents. One of the presidents after that invited him to go to a particular social thing, and he says, I'll never go anywhere with any presidents. He saw three presidents. But on that note...
He was like the Forrest Gump of presidents of death.
I know it. Okay, my name is Ken Gidge. This has been The Art of Politics. You can get me at Gidge World, which is an art website, or you can get me on a telephone, 603-864-9332, on Facebook. Also, my email address, kgidge@aol.com.
And I'm Bill O'Brien. I'm a state representative from Mount Vernon. And you can reach me on my telephone at 620-8710 on Facebook, or send me an email. It's William L. O'Brien, no period, no apostrophe, @gmail.com.
Okay.
Thanks, Ken.
Good. Thank you. Next time.
The preceding program was provided by an independent producer solely responsible for its content. The opinions expressed do not necessarily represent the views of this station, its staff, board of directors, or underwriters.